Welcome. I'm Father John Cusick, and along with Father Tom Hurley and some wonderful people from our family school, we're going to do something today that I always enjoy doing. It's been a long time doing this. We're going to do a celebration of Catholic Mass. Father Hurley will preside at Mass, and I'm going to do Harry Carey. I'm going to do a running commentary to help us try to explain. And so I welcome those of you who are in the family school that hangs out here at Old St. Patrick's Church, and those of you who are in the RCIA, Rite of Christian Initiation of Adults, also at St. Pat's. And hopefully this will be a learning thing for us, because Catholic Mass can be a little bit complicated sometimes because there's so many moving parts. Let me try to get us in the mood this way. A number of years ago, a gentleman was sitting next to me at Wrigley Field, and we got some small talk, and he was had a heavy accent, spoke good English, but he had a very heavy German accent. And he said he had never been at an American ballpark, and he had never been to a baseball game. Well, about three or four times an inning, he would lean over and say, "What's that, and what's that, and how about that?" And if you want something that's extremely challenging, and you're a baseball fan, try to explain baseball to somebody who's never been at a baseball game. It's not that simple, because it seems that every time you got a rule, there's four reasons why that rule doesn't necessarily apply here. And so I had fun doing it, and he went away, but he left in about the fifth inning. You know, a little wussy there. Come on, you got to stay for all nine. But anyhow, this is what reminded me of that. So before Father Hurley begins celebrating Mass, I want to a little bit, there's a whole bunch of things that surround us that I think are fascinating. First of all, we have an altar. Well, the altar, like anything that we're going to be talking about today and Father Hurley will be celebrating, has got a ton of explanations as things went through history. So for example, the first and the earliest understanding of an altar was way back in the first book of the Torah, the first book of the Hebrew Testament, the book of Genesis, when Cain and Abel were sacrificing. And they would take an animal, they would slaughter the animal, and on an altar, they would cook the animal. And the idea being, now this is a primitive world, understand that, very primitive ancient world. The smoke would rise up to the heavens. And like any one of us, if somebody at home is cooking a wonderful meal and you walk in, you take a couple of those deep breaths from the nose and the chest, and you know exactly what it is, and it caught your attention. Well, the earliest understanding of sacrifice at the altar was that as the smoke went up to the heavens, what you were looking for was the attention of God above. And who could ever be non-attentive to the smell of a good meal? And so they would say, well, now that we have your attention, there's a few things down here we need to go over. And so that's how that began. Well, throughout history, that changed. And in Christian circles, after a while, this is also called the table of the Lord. And it was at a table, not probably as high and tall, because those are all changed in history, where the Lord celebrated Passover on the night before he died. We call that Holy Thursday. And it was at the altar of the Lord, where they had their Passover meal, they had their bread and their wine, and he said, now whenever you do this in the future, do this in memory of me. So we've got an altar, we've got a table of the Lord, and they flip back and forth. There's going to be a third reason, but I'm going to hold on to that for just a second. So that's where we start with that. Secondly, there's candles. Now you got to remember that a lot of sacred things had very, very secular and pragmatic reasons to be around. Do you know why there are candles sometimes on an altar? There are candles in a Jewish Shabbat on Friday nights. You light your candles, you say the prayer of the light, blessed are you, Lord our God, on and on. Well, it wasn't sacred at first. Do you know why you had candles? Because there was no electricity. So you had candles so you could see. And certainly, in a Jewish home that celebrates Shabbat on Friday, when does Shabbat begin? Sundown. And so, sundown in the winter, it's going to get dark quick and fast. And you have lights so you can see, perhaps say the prayers, see one another, whatever the participative things really are. Now, sometimes in Catholic circles, you'd have people would come into a church, particularly like a cathedral or one of those great big churches, and there would be all kinds of candles. And you say, oh man, something special is going on here today. Well, it could be that the bishop is going to celebrate Mass. And the bishop was usually an older guy. And what do older people need? Light. So they put more candles out there so the bishop could see, say the prayers, so on and so forth. Now it's sacred. You walk in, you see candles. It surrounds a sacred place. And I'm sure, again, to our family school members, at Shabbat, you light your candles, you say their prayer with it, and this is not just any ordinary Friday night dinner. This is something that's very, very special. So that's where we go with the candles. It gives light. It's now. You want to have some interesting fun. In every Catholic, this is what's called the sanctuary. In every Catholic sanctuary, there have been fundamentally four pieces of furniture. From St. Peter's in Rome to St. Patrick's in Chicago. Now they're modified a little bit as time goes on. But the four pieces of furniture are the altar, the chair for the priest presider. I think this used to be called the pulpit. It's now called an ambo. I don't know how things get changed. And then on the other side, there was a place to cantor the sacred songs. Those were the four pieces of furniture. Do you know what the origin of that is? That is a Roman law court. Place for the judge, table of justice, one side defense, one side prosecution. Because you see, the Catholic Christian community for the first 300 years of its existence was really persecuted. And it was underground, it was in hiding. But in around the year 313, 315, somewhere around there, the Roman Emperor, Constantine, for some reason known to him, decided that he would convert to Christianity. And you know the old adage, what's good for the emperor is good for the empire? Well, all of a sudden now, when the lid comes off, you've got all these people who are choosing Christianity to be baptized, so on and so forth. Well, what do you need? You need a place to gather, because you can't just gather in Harry's basement any longer. So what was the most common public space in the empire? A law court. And so they went inside, and the conversion was real quick. It went from your honor to father. It went from the altar of the Lord, or the table of the Lord, to the table of justice. You take the prosecution, turn it around, and it goes out this way instead of going towards the judge, and you do the same thing on the other side. So it was a very, very simple conversion, and it's modified itself throughout history. But if you look around in any church, you'll see where those four pieces are in one way or another, and that's the fundamental furniture that occupies a Catholic sanctuary. Now, people complain. You know what the problem with you Catholics? You're like you're in the army. Stand, sit, kneel, up, down. There are four postures in Catholic Mass. We stand, we sit, we kneel, and I forgot the fourth already. And we genuflect. Okay, let's go over that. Standing is simple. You stand when we begin Mass because what are we going to do? We are going to welcome. Standing is a posture of welcome. And in many churches, there'll be a procession up the aisle. Something is going to happen. I remember when Rabbi Setcher had me as his guest at Shabbat over at Macomb Shalom many years ago. And then when they brought the Torah out of the tabernacle, people stood. You stood to welcome the presence of Yahweh God in the Torah, the law. We stand to welcome our clergy and perhaps our readers. And interestingly, we stand during Mass for the gospel. That's the third of the three readings. You're going to see, so that's standing. Why do we sit? Sitting is the posture of a pupil, of a learner. And if my history serves me correct, in the Jewish community, the rabbi would gather learners, students around, and they would literally sit at the feet of the rabbi. And so often in some of the artwork in Christianity, the Lord Jesus would be there and the apostles would be seating around him. We have that in the Gospel of Matthew. He called his apostles forward, they sat down, and he began to teach. So sitting, we sit another time during Mass, but that's the primary understanding of it. And kneeling, we don't do all of that much. Sometimes you'll see people when they come into a Catholic church, they'll genuflect, we'll get to that in a second, and they'll come into their pew and they'll either sit down or they will kneel. And sometimes for me, kneeling is just getting my head on from what I had been doing 20 minutes before. And I can be reflective, I can raise to my consciousness things that are important to me that I want to put in God's hands. But it's also sometimes a posture of adoration. We kneel before the Lord. This has become a rub once in a while between the Jewish and the Christian communities. They will kneel before nobody. And so consequently, in more parts of Catholic Mass today, there's more standing out of deference to Jewish people. I think that's a wonderful, wonderful step forward. And then the last one is genuflection. Genuflection is when you come in, you're in the presence of somebody, and you go down on one knee, it hits the ground, and then you come up. I would do it, but I couldn't get up. And Father Hurley would have to come up and get a hook and lift me up. But you might have seen some of those crazy old movies. I call them like out of Britain or France, and royalty would be going by in a horse-drawn thing, and the horses be going real fast, and there'd be curtains on the side, but you know inside was the king or the queen or somebody like that. And common folk would fall to their knee and genuflect before royalty. Well, there's an old saying, grace builds on nature. Sometimes the religious symbol system is built on what people see in secular life. You can hear people saying this, hey, wait a second. If you can genuflect to the king, we'll genuflect to Christ the king. That's the king we worship. And so amazingly, oftentimes what Catholics will do is they'll look for the tabernacle. And when they come in, they will genuflect to the tabernacle. The tabernacle is our holy of holies. And what was kept in the Holy of Holies among the Hebrew people? Two things, the Torah, the five books of what we call the Old Testament or the Hebrew Testament, and the bread, the manna that fell to the earth when they were on their way to the Promised Land. They had bread, holy bread. What do we have in there? Holy bread. The more things change, the more they stay the same. Going back for a second to candles. I'm sure where it is. There it is. Way in the corner, if you can't see it, you probably can't. There's what we call a sanctuary lamp. We stole that from the Jewish people. Next to the tabernacle in the Holy of Holies, always burned one candle. It was a sign of presence. Yahweh has pitched his tent with his people. And they lighted a candle to remind that. That is our sanctuary lamp. That the Lord is with us, pitched a tent with us, and in the sacred bread consecrated at Catholic Mass, what's left over is kept in that tabernacle. So those are the four postures. We stand, we sit, we kneel, we genuflect. And I think we're pretty much, there's four, okay, color. There's going to be two things left, color and clothes. There are four colors in Catholic worship. There's green. Father Hurley is wearing green. There's a green covering on the table of the Lord. And green is what is called ordinary time. It's not a festival. It's not Christmas. It's not Easter. It's not a wedding. It's just plain old ordinary time. And the color of ordinariness, particularly in the summer, is green. The earth in the northern hemisphere turns green. And this is a reminder that this is what we call the ordinary time of the year. There's white. The white vestment is celebratory. So it's weddings, it's Christmas, it's Easter, anything really, really festive. And in the Catholic community, unlike other parts of the Christian community, white is also the color we use at funerals, because we believe that life is stronger than death. And the symbol of life is the color white. And so we've got green, we have white, we have purple, or sometimes today it's like a blue. In Advent, right before Christmas, for 4 weeks, the color was purple. It's more of a let's get our act together kind of color. It's more somber. It's during the 6 weeks of Lent. That's the time where we try to be reflective, break our lives open, get a little bit better, so on and so forth. And the color of that when you walk in the church is purple, and you say, oh my God, it's Lent. I better take care of that. And the last color is red. And red has got two reasons. Number one, red is the color of blood. It's the color of martyrs. People who have shed their blood for their faith. But red is also the color of the Spirit of God. Like tongues of fire, the Spirit came down upon the apostles. And a tongue of fire is usually red. And so in our tradition, that would be Good Friday, very sacred, where we commemorate the death of the Lord. It would be Pentecost, when the Spirit came down. So those are the four colors, and usually when you walk into a church or see a priest, you know exactly what the time of the year is. So those are the colors. Now lastly, and then Father Hurley is going to begin Mass, there's two fundamental garments. One is white. It's called an alb, A-L-B. It comes from the Latin word albus, which means white. Imagine that. But there's a sacred understanding to it, and then there's a practical understanding to it. When we get through winter, and we begin to see more pictures coming out of the Middle East, what is the common basic outerwear of Middle Eastern men? Long white. You'll see Saudi men, all those different countries. Why white? Number one, white reflects heat. They did not have a lot of air conditioning, believe it or not. And number two, why was it long? It protected you from the sand that kept blowing off of the deserts of the Middle East so it doesn't rip your clothes. So white was very, very practical. Christianity took the white cloth, and it's a sign of a baptized person. In one of our sacred texts, they came into the tomb looking for Jesus after Good Friday, and they saw two men dressed in white. That was a symbol of baptism, of people who were faithful to the tradition. And then on the outside is a stole, S-T-O-L-E, and in the Jewish tradition, it's called a talis. It is not as fancy as maybe you guys and gals will get when you have your bat mitzvah, your bar mitzvah, because each of the little knots at the end. It's got a meaning. There's so many there because there's so many laws and so on and so forth. Well, there's again a secular reason and a religious reason. Number one, the secular. A stole over your shoulders going down was a symbol of a Roman senator. When the church got out of persecution and Constantine took the lid off, they needed to establish themselves in terms of credibility in the Roman Empire. And so clergy, for the first time, had a symbol of their clergy, which was a stole, which they stole from the Roman senators. And then secondly, it was sacred. It resembled the prayer shawl of Jewish people, keeping in mind that the earliest roots of Christianity were Jewish, Hebrew. And so you've got stole, alb, and there's an outer garment that's called a chasuble, big fancy word. It just finishes the vestment, and it's always in the color of the day. And again, we said, this is green, and it goes over your head. It usually has a symbol of a cross or some Christian religious symbol in it. A cowl, which is that great big neckline, oftentimes in other people who are monks and in religious orders, like Brojo back there, the cowl can go over your head like a hoodie. That's it. So we're ready to roll. Is that fair? Father Hurley will welcome everyone. And how do we welcome people? When the priest comes out, we stand to greet the presence of God in our religious service.
Great. I also continue to add my word of welcome to all of you, to those who are viewing and appreciating this wonderful explanation of our Catholic liturgy, to those in the family school, to those in RCIA, and to others who might enjoy this in the years to come. As John indicated, we do stand as a sign of welcoming the Lord into this space and into our hearts, and we always begin with an opening song. And so Laura and Dominic are going to lead us now in our opening song.
What is it we call the sign of the cross? And it really is our symbolic way of talking about the three ways we see the incarnate God moving through life. The Father, a patriarch who led people into freedom to the promised land, the Son, whom we call Jesus, and the Spirit of God that dwells with us all of our days. And so there's a symbol with that, and it begins.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And may the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
As we prepare to enter and to celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us call to mind our sins.
Now, isn't that Catholic? Let us call to mind our sins. Let's get the guilt stuff going real fast. Oh, my God, let's feel really crummy and, oh, get all my sins out here. No, it's the exact opposite. You know what it means if you take it out of fancy language? Let us call to mind our sins means get it out of the way. Don't hang on to that stuff. Don't let it be driving your brain. Because if you can get clean and move that away, you'll have much more space inside to hear the word of God, to participate in the rituals, and to separate yourself from stuff that is never coming back. That's why we call to mind our sins. Get it out of there.
Lord Jesus, you came to call us each by name, your sons and daughters. You love us equally. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you gather us in this holy place. You call us to be a holy people so that we'll go forth and build up the kingdom as you want it. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
And Lord Jesus, as John often says, we don't always get it right. We might say the wrong things or do the wrong things, and for all those times, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
So may Almighty God have mercy on us then, free us and forgive us of our sins, and bring us all one day to everlasting life. Amen.
Pray. Let us pray.
And let us pray.
This is called the opening prayer. But you had to hear the beginning. It's an invitation for all of us to pray. And this is where there should be a pause so that all of us can go inside of ourselves and put some words to the prayers and the things that are inside of us. Now, it had another name in history, and I like the other name better. It was called the collect, C-O-L-L-E-C-T. It meant that once we pray, our priest presider will collect symbolically the prayers of all of us, and in our name, send them off in a prayer to God, and we always pray through Christ our Lord. Amen.
So let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, who governs all things both in heaven and on earth, mercifully hear the pleading of your people and bestow your peace upon our times. And we ask you this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Now we have a posture change. We are to be seated for the readings. Now, there are three readings, and I don't like the name, readings. I mean, it sounds like you're reading the New York Times. There's another name. They were called the lessons. And if they are the lessons or the teachings, and we have the posture of a learner, what we have now is the first lesson. And the way they are connected is that the first reading is from the Hebrew Testament, or some of us continue to call it the Old Testament. That's the promise. And the third one is going to be the gospel, which we claim is the fulfillment. And the middle one, which is usually from letters that St. Paul wrote to early Christian communities, I call those the old fire 'em up talk. It's the locker room talk. Come on, guys, get your act together for God's sake. Remember what the Lord did? It's about time we got it right. Sometimes you're going to get a kick in the fanny through the reading. Sometimes you're going to get an attagirl. And that's always the fire 'em up thing. But to me, the two most important are the first and the third. The first.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses spoke to the people saying, "Fear the Lord your God, and keep throughout the days of your lives all his statutes and commandments which I enjoin on you, and thus have long life. Hear then, Israel, and be careful to observe them, that you may grow and prosper the more, in keeping with the promise of the Lord, the God of your fathers, to keep them, to give you a land flowing with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. Therefore you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. Take to heart these words which I enjoin you on today, the word of the Lord."
Thanks be to God. What follows is called a responsorial psalm, responsorial song or psalm. It's a response to the reading. The original hymn book in the scripture is the book of Psalms. It's in the Hebrew Testament. It's sung by us. There's 150 psalms, which originally were 150 songs that had, they were all set to music. And it's from the book of Psalms that people would reflect on what they just heard. We've tweaked that a little bit throughout history, but that's its origin and its beginning. Our second reading is going to be the locker room talk. It's going to be the encouragement we need to keep moving forward with being the chosen people of God.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other command there may be, are summed up in this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor, therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. And do this, understanding the present time. The hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over, the day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us behave decently as in the daytime, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in immorality and debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. Rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the flesh.
Now there'll be a posture change as we have an Alleluia celebrating the presence of Christ that comes through Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. We stand to welcome the presence of the Lord in our midst, and off we go.
Alleluia, alleluia. May the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
This day we read from the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark. Glory to you, Lord.
People always ask, why do Catholics sometimes before the Gospel go like this and this and this? Well, there's a little prayer usually that goes with that. May the Lord be in my mind, on my lips, and in my heart, that I may worthily listen to the Gospel of Jesus. I tweak it, being a priest, and I'll say, may the Lord be in my mind, on my lips, and in my heart, that I may worthily proclaim the Gospel of the Lord.
One of the scribes came to Jesus and asked him, which is the first of all the commandments? To which Jesus replied, this is the first. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second one is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. The scribe said to Jesus, well said, teacher. You are right in saying he is one and there is no other than he, and to love him with all your heart and all your understanding and with all your strength and to love your neighbor as yourself is worth more than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. And when Jesus saw that he answered with understanding, he said to him, you are not far from the kingdom of God. And no one dared to ask him any more questions. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Now what follows, because now we're going to be seated because we're going to be learners, is it called a homily. Now a homily, there are two words here, a homily or a sermon. A sermon is topical. So I say, hey, Father Hurley, what are you going to be talking about today in church? And Father Hurley would say, how the White Sox are better than the Cubs. That's a topic. A homily is hard work because it's not a topic. A homily is listening to that gospel, and then the priest presider or the deacon has got to figure out how those words work in our world today. They're thousands of years old, and we have to figure out how they fit into what we do each and every day. And I'm telling you, as somebody who's done this for 50 years, it ain't easy. Well, here's the pro.
Yeah. Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. So that's the Shema that our Jewish friends in the family school know far better than me, but I've learned it along the way. There was a story that our common friend, Rabbi Hava, told some years ago when we were downstairs in Hughes Hall and she and I were presiding over a morning service for the family school. And she told this story, and it's a story that comes in the aftermath of World War II. And in the aftermath of World War II, when the war was ended and the Holocaust, that evil had finally come to an end, what people discovered is that so many children were left behind and so many children were taken into orphanages, and many orphanages throughout Europe that were run by priests and sisters of the Catholic faith. But so many of those children came from so many different traditions. And the story is told that there was a rabbi who came, and there were people, in addition to the rabbi, who were seeking to find and to make connections with some of the children, with some of their family members who survived the Holocaust. And so there weren't papers on many of the children, and so they didn't really know who belonged to who. And so one of the rabbis suggested to those who were running the orphanage, would you let me come in here at night when the children are sleeping? And when the children are sleeping, and then I'll call out. And so at night, the rabbi came in as the children were sleeping, and began, Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. And all of a sudden, from the darkness of the dormitory of the orphanage, you could hear little voices saying, Mama, Mama? When Haba told that story, I got chills, and sometimes I still get chills even when I retell that very powerful story. Mama? Mama? Because in Jewish families, this prayer, the Shema, that is prayed every day, children probably have learned it because they sat on the laps of their mothers and their fathers, and they've heard those sacred words. What's so powerful about those words and that experience, as they called out in the darkness, is that there's something that's always a part of us. There's something that runs through us. And whether we're Jews or whether we're Christians, there is this holy, there is this experience that runs through us, that rinses through us, and that in a very powerful way connects us. And that's why I find it so beautiful as we gather for this liturgy today and we hear these words from Luke's gospel, when the question is asked by the scribe, the scholar of the law, what's the greatest commandment? Jesus knew what to say. It's that which connects us all. Hear, O Israel, God is one. And we're going to love God with everything we have, our heart, soul, our mind, our strength. And you know what? And when that rinses through us, then maybe we'll go forth and we'll live this in the world and we'll love neighbor as we would love ourselves. So as we gather this day, let's not forget all that is within us. This God who rinses through us and this God who calls us out into the world. Let us remember that we are connected. Let us remember the one who calls us together and the one who invites us to go forth to build the kingdom of God.
Now what follows is what we call the creed. You see, out of all of the stories of Scripture, from the Hebrew Testament to the writings of St. Paul today from the book of Romans, to the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, when you begin to see all the divine activity moving, people began to say, well, what does that tell us? What do we believe out of that? That became the creed. It was a statement of beliefs. And a very simple one that is used in the Catholic tradition is what we call the Apostles' Creed. And so what we normally would do after being seated for a homily from Father Hurley, we would stand because we are telling God, I'm proud of my faith, and this is what we believe. And so that's what we will do.
So we blend heart and voice as we proclaim this tradition handed on. I believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. So we gather our needs, our promises, all that we hold dear, and we place them now in the very hand of God.
Now, these are called the prayers of the faithful. Now, we've got to understand something here. This is not a time when we pray for ourselves and our own needs. We've done that already. At the beginning of Mass, when Father Hurley said, let us pray, that's our time to put it out there before the Lord. This is the time we take all the stuff we've done before, the readings and everything, and turn our attention outside of the four walls, outside of our own selfish but important needs. And we look to the world. What needs our prayer? What do we want to turn over and put in God's hands? And so that's what the prayer of the faithful is. It's not, oftentimes I'll hear people say, if they, I want to pray for a special intention. I want to pray for a special intention. Tell me what it is. We're not hiding anything. It's got to be, though, not for my cancer treatment. We've done that already. It's got to be for the oncology people who are caring for cancer patients. That's how this works and how it should work.
May we truly love the Lord with all our hearts, all our souls,
and all our mind and all our strength. And in loving our neighbors as ourselves, may we help to bring about, to come olam, the healing of divisions in the world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family school and for all interfaith families, sharing their religious traditions with their children, treasuring their own with deep respect for each other's, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those preparing for the rite of Christian initiation for adults, embracing the mission of Jesus Christ, so that others may experience the rich promise of God's love for our world, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the blessings of community and gratitude to be on our faith journeys with each other, and for Old St. Patrick's Church hosting us with radical inclusivity, exquisite worship, and transformative kinship, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are ailing in body, mind, or spirit, may healing come soon. And for those who love and care for them, as we name them silently in our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have passed on to life eternal, may they live on in the hearts of those who cherish their memories, and may they not be far from the kingdom of God, as we name them silently in our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Holy God, help us always to hold sacred the beautiful traditions and customs handed on to us. You are one, so help us to be one in mind, in heart, in soul, and in how we treat one another. Continue to rinse your love through us now and always, so that we'll bring that love to the world. Hear our prayers that we offer you through Christ our Lord. Amen. Can I invite you to please be seated?
We've changed our posture, and there's not a lot of symbolism right now. It's just a time to prepare the altar. Now, historically, what did it mean to prepare the altar? Well, first of all, it could be bringing forth alms, because the concern was for always those less fortunate in the community. This is how we gathered different things together. So it could be food, it could be money, it could be a variety of things which were brought up and placed on the altar of the Lord. And then in the Christian tradition, we always place there the food that was used at that last Passover, that last supper, bread and wine. Would you believe this is the end of the first part of Mass? Liturgy of the Word, Liturgy of the Eucharist, and then Communion. Actually, with a little tweaking here and there, this was pretty much a first century in the common era, temple or synagogue service. It was the readings, the bringing, sharing of alms, a little preaching, a little teaching on what the scripture really means to us, and then people would be off and on their way. Well, then the Christians added the next section. You see, the earliest believers were all Jews, and they were expelled from their towns because of this Jesus, and I'm convinced that Jesus had no idea of starting a church, but they gathered around his word, and people just didn't like that, so they threw them out, and what did they do? They took their prayers with them. They took their ritual with them, and then they began to add the story of the breaking of the bread, and that was what Jesus did at the Last Supper, and they gave it a name. They called it the Eucharistic prayer, which means give thanks, and someone told me once, we can have the worst day of our life, miserable day, and I bet you we can find something for which we're thankful. So thanksgiving is fundamental to human beings, and it becomes the centerpiece now of the next part of Catholic Mass, the Eucharistic prayer.
So grant, O Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries. For whenever the memorial of the sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished. We pray through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
And let us give thanks then to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It's good for us to gather always and everywhere to give you our thanks, Almighty and Eternal God. Although you have no need of our praise, our thanksgiving is itself your gift. Our praises don't add to your greatness, O God, but they profit us for salvation. They help us to grow as disciples on this journey through Jesus, our risen Lord. So then, with the angels and the saints, we blend our hearts and our voices together as we proclaim. Indeed, holy Lord, and you're the font and you're the source of everything that's holy. So we ask you now, send forth your spirit, make holy these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. For on the night before he died, he gathered first with his friends at a table. He took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it, gave it to them, and he said, take this, all of you, eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the cup filled with wine. Once more, after giving thanks, he handed it to his friends, and he said, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. A mystery of faith.
Now this needs a little explanation, the mystery of faith. Why would we put mystery in the middle of a prayer of thanksgiving? Well, mystery comes from the Greek, mysterion. And mysterion meant drama. And some of you far more learned than I know that in Greek drama, Greek theater, there were only two types of dramas, tragedy and comedy. And so what we're doing here is we're proclaiming the drama of our faith, which we've just said in thanksgiving, what the Lord did at the Last Supper, and we recall those words, and the Lord becomes present with us. Drama, Christ has died, that's a tragedy. Christ has risen, that's a comedy. Comedy didn't mean rah-rah. Comedy meant that somehow in some way, when the curtain comes down, everything works out okay. That is the classic understanding of comedy. Christ has died, tragedy. Christ has risen, comedy. Christ will come again, comedy. The mystery of faith in our tradition, and certainly we've learned this from Jewish people, is not a tragedy. As bad as it looks, somehow in some way, when the curtain comes down, it's a comedy given to us by God that everything somehow can work out.
Therefore, as we gather to celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer to you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of blessing, giving thanks that you've held us all worthy to be here in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray now that as we share in the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. And Lord, remember your church that is spread throughout the world. Remember all the various traditions, especially our Jewish sisters and brothers, as we celebrate this special Mass today. Bring us all to the fullness of charity and understanding and our reverence and our respect for one another. Together with Francis, our Pope, Blaise, our Bishop, and all of your people, remember too all of our sisters and our brothers who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light and peace of your presence. Have mercy on us, we pray, that with Mary, the Virgin Mother of God, Joseph, her husband, the apostles and martyrs, St. Patrick and St. Bridget, St. Maximilian Kolbe, Francis Xavier Ward, all those holy women and men who have pleased you throughout the ages, that we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and praise and glorify you through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Through him, with him, and him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
The singing of what we call the Great Amen, the second part of Catholic Mass ends, the Liturgy of the Eucharist. And now we move into the final part before dismissal. It's called the Rite of Communion. Communion means union with. You're going to see here a progression that gets us closer together in a human community that allows us to be connected to a divine source of life in Holy Communion. And so we're going to begin with the prayer that is distinguished as probably, if the Shema is the prayer of Jewish people, the Lord's Prayer, the Our Father, is really the prayer of Christian people. But let me give you a few things about this that you might find fascinating. Number one, there are three very, very important English words that are not found in the prayer of the Our Father. There's no I, there's no me, and there's no my. There is an our, a we, and an us. You can't be an individual and say, I'm going to be gathered with my God. No, no, no. It's our God. It's our Father. And the our is not just those who are in our family or in our little tradition. Our is the human community. This is the call to unity. This is the call to communion. Number two, I always find it interesting, because Catholics, we can rattle this thing off. I can do the Our Father in one breath. I've been at this a long time. And I remember my mom and dad would say, did you say your prayers? Get out of bed and get on your knees. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. The kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. If you slow it down, for how long when Jesus taught this prayer did he ask people to pray to be fed? One day. give us this day our daily bread. For anybody who today is working a 12-step program through AA, for how long do they commit to be sober? Today. One day. Well, what about tomorrow? We're not there yet. Let's not get our shorts in a knot. And so the Lord told us to calm down, pray to be fed today by the love and the food of God. I don't know about you, that's a pretty good strategy.
So then, we gather our voices and our hearts and we pray that simple prayer that Jesus taught his friends. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, we pray, Lord, from every evil graciously. Grant peace to us in our days. By the help of your mercy, keep us all free from sin, safe from all of our worries and our fears, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord, you said to your friends, peace. Peace I leave you, and peace is the gift I want you to give away. Look not on our sins, but look rather on the faith of your church, and graciously grant us peace and unity in accordance with your will, as you live and reign forever and ever. Amen.
Now, why would we throw in things on peace right here? It's the progression, beginning with the Our Father. We, us, and ours. Once we commit to say that it's our God, all of us, then we got to figure out what we do with those parts that don't always work. Where do we need to find peace and extend peace? And here, I believe, the Hebrew concept of shalom, which is translated as peace, is to me the most powerful. I've always been taught that shalom really means the healing of relationships. Again, we can't say that we're going to be in communion with God if we're fighting everybody. And I think today, in the crazy world in which we live, with so many people and family and friends who can't even talk to each other anymore, but then they'll run to church, run to temple, because God's going to take care of them. I don't know about you, I got a problem with that. So we got to somehow find a way to shalom, be at peace with one another. Now, in the Christian tradition, peace has got another very, very fascinating beginning. It was two soldiers who wished peace to an enemy. And what did they have to do? In an ancient world, they had to put down a shield. They had to put down a sword. They had to open their palm to another human being who was their enemy. And they had to reach out, totally vulnerable, and hope that the gentleman, usually men, on the other side would do the exact same thing. I don't know about you, but that sounds like peace to me, because you're going to make it, and you're not going to get killed. And that's what the world can do when we stay in touch with one another. Embrace each other in God's love, so that together we can all say amen to God's communion with us and us with God. That is shalom. That is peace.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
For a moment then, why don't we offer that shalom, that peace to those around us.
To everybody. Peace to you. Peace, Tom.
Peace, Jen.
Peace, Dominic. Peace, Laura. Thank you guys for reading.
Thank you.
without any words spoken, Father Hurley took what we call the large host, the large piece of unleavened bread, and he broke it. In the Gospel of Luke, they discovered the Lord Jesus after the resurrection in the breaking of bread. And that was the action that just went on. What does that mean? There were times in the Hebrew tradition when people would gather for Passover. And they now could come from different places, but there was always one larger unleavened bread, and they would break off a piece, and they would put it with all the other broken off pieces. And the idea was, we're one people, we're Jews, we're Hebrews, and yet we're all individuals bringing all of our lives with us. So to understand unity and diversity, they broke off a piece, and that was the breaking of bread.
Behold God's Lamb, Jesus who takes away the sins of the world, happy should all of us be who are called to the banquet of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
So what we have done is taken the words of the Last Supper of the Lord Jesus pretty literally and pretty importantly. Do this in memory of me. And that's what we've been doing, in the memory of the Lord. And memory always meant look to the past so that you can do it again in the future. Push life forward by remembering the power of got you to this moment. That is what we've been doing. And that's where we're in communion with God, because we are now in communion with one another. Coming to communion? Hoped that there would be time after we have received communion to be still for a minute or two. It's getting harder and harder to do because on Sunday, in good days, you've got to move 800 people out to get 800 people in, and it's an economy of time. But I think sometimes we need to say, what just happened here? To whom did I say amen? How am I going to deal with that? How do I speak to the Lord? And this is the time to do that, prayerfully, thankfully, gratefully. And then when we've done that, it's just a simple prayer that the priest will say, prayer of gratitude. We're going to get a blessing, and we're going to be told to get out of here and take this to the street and to live it. This is called a dismissal.
And let us pray. Pour out upon us, O God, the great spirit of your love and of your kindness. Make those of us whom you have nourished today with this one heavenly bread, one in mind, in heart, in soul, and strength, and love. And we ask you this through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be with you. And may God bless us and bless us kindly. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Now the blessing. There's an old and probably still time-honored tradition. When people are about to get married, it's usually the gentleman who goes to the father of the woman he loves and says, I want to spend the rest of my life with your daughter. Can I have your blessing? Well, that's classic and it's wonderful. It means, can I have your approval? So when we ask the Lord to bless us, the Lord is saying, yeah, honest to God, you know something? I love you guys. The Father loves you, the Son loves you, the Spirit of God loves you. Remember who you are, that you are loved by God. Now there's another word for this once in a while. It's called benediction. And bene dicere in Latin means to say good things. And that's what this blessing is. Father Hurley is saying, you're loved, you're blessed, you're cared for. That's how you are seen and cared for by God. So that is blessing. Now, we got one last thing to do. Figure a way how to get out of here. And we're going to use a Latin phrase, which has been twisted around, but when I was a kid, it made all the sense in the world. It said, ite missa est. Ite means go. Get out of here. Take what we've done. Take the food you've been given and give it to someone else. Take the words. Live them. Let people see there's such a wonderful God as ours.
So the Mass is ended. We go forth in peace now to love and to serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.